High inflation and land issues have tested the Philippine real estate sector in recent years. And in the case of warehouse supply, business boomed as e-commerce soared during the pandemic.
But as elevated prices begin to bite on consumer spending, how is the industry doing and adapting? Joining us now to discuss that is Jet Yu, the founder and CEO of Prime Philippines, a real estate consultancy firm that describes itself as built by millennials and young achievers. Speaking of which, the young achiever is here.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you for joining us tonight. So I was very curious about your business. What do you actually do? It's not like the usual real estate consultancy firm. You are focusing on warehousing specifically.
Okay, thank you for that. Well, Prime Philippines started way back in 2013. I started a company and we focus primarily on commercial real estate.
Commercial.
And we established the warehouse brokerage group way back in 2017, so we've closely monitored the market ahead of time before the boom of the industrial sector. And right now Prime Philippines, we're present in Manila, Cebu and Davao. And I just want to mention, during the pandemic, due to our nationwide presence, we were able to be part of the vital operations of a lot of the e-commerce.
Right.
So when 2020 happened, there was a lockdown and the e-commerce grew by two or threefold just in 1 year. And Prime Philippines was there to cater to their warehouse requirements across
How
the country.
How was it during that time when the boom was happening and you were there at the right time, at the right place? How was it going? How did it feel?
Well, that time it was very challenging, of course, because our people they had to go out and meet with landlords and also fulfill the requirements of our clients. Mm-hmm. So all of these e-commerce companies, they're all based in Manila. Okay, so when the pandemic happened, no one anticipated that they would need to be in Visayas and Mindanao, and the e-commerce growth will actually happen across the Philippines. So our team had to do a lot of remote transactions, which part of it is remote viewing, remote negotiation, remote contract signings. Mm-hmm. So by June or July, I think we were able to, 3 months after the pandemic, after the first lockdown, we were able to close already nearly about 100 to 200,000 square meters of warehouses just in Visayas and Mindanao regions.
Mm-hmm. So safe to say during that time you made more money than the previous year?
For Prime in general, I'd like to say that we had to adapt also, mm-hmm. just like any other companies. Mm-hmm. So many of our team, even from the office, leasing, brokerage, had to adjust and also they had to be flexible and cater to the requirements of BPOs also, who are right-sizing during that time and who are opening satellite offices outside Metro Manila to be closer to where the residents or their talents lives.
Coming from the pandemic and coming from that boom, where is it now? What's the status of the industry? Has it gone down dramatically from then?
For the industrial sector, it's been steadily growing since 2017. Then 2020, we experienced a surge of demand due to the lockdowns. And starting second half of 2022, I think it already stabilized. It's the more organic demand from the industrial occupiers. No? So during this first half of 2023, what we've seen is that the industrial sector is already at the phase of stabilized growth. More e-commerce companies right now are the third-party logistics that are backing the e-commerce companies are now consolidating their warehouses because of some had overexpanded during the pandemic.
Got too excited
about the growth, which I don't think that it's actually bad. No, I think it's just natural.
It was an anticipation.
Yes.
you know, it's precisely because of that over expansion where the delivery boys going to Ron's place already know his name.
Not a lot, just a few. I have favorite ones.
But I was thinking, this would be a better indicator, actually, a forward-looking indicator of economic activity, because mm-hmm. all the economic numbers Ron and I report about on a daily basis, mm-hmm. they're lagging indicators. But when you say growing but more stable, what rate would that be?
Okay, that's a good question. For example, as of this first half of 2023, we monitored the total warehouse supply across the Philippines at 37 million square meters. Last year, 2022, it was around 34 million. So due to our active efforts of pursuing landlords last year to open industrial parks or build your warehouses because there's a lack of supply, by this time around, first half of 2023, we're averaging still about 90%+ occupancy. And for some regions, there were some decimal points decline in occupancy rates, which I don't consider significant. Mm-hmm. But in some other regions, there are single-digit increase in occupancy rates. So perhaps that's what I mean when I say that there's a stabilized growth. Mm-hmm. It's not like 2020, it's two or three times the growth of warehouse tenants and occupiers.
So even though there's inflation, even though there's still a little bit of uncertainty, and employment numbers are good, we hope that GDP will be the highest in Asia. People are still spending. Mm-hmm. They're still spending via e-commerce, but the slowdown, a little bit of a slowdown or stabilization, does that mean they're still spending, but some are spending in malls now, or in, you know, they're physically present in the stores?
That's right. I think this is the more organic market for e-commerce, because people now are free to go out. They go to malls. But of course, we see that there is definitely a permanent adoption of the e-commerce market. So it's not going to go away for sure. What I want to at least mention here is also not just demand from the e-commerce companies. There's also a huge opportunity from international companies who are interested to expand their manufacturing facilities here in the country. No? So to give you an idea, over the last 2 or 3 years, on an estimate, let's say we brought in and met with about 10 international companies who are all in the manufacturing sector. Only one actually proceeded with their expansion in the Philippines. And that's where I want to highlight the opportunity for the Philippines, not just being reliant on what we have right now, such as tourism, BPO, and so on. The manufacturing sector, I think, is also a sleeping giant that we can unlock and open up. 60% of those companies that we met the past 2 to 3 years went to Vietnam. But they all went to the Philippines and checked all the industrial parks that we presented.
What possibly could have turned them off and chose Vietnam instead of us?
Just like any companies, they look at the cost. Mm. I think that's a primary consideration. Through the CREATE law, I think it lessened the attractiveness of the Philippines for foreign companies to consider expanding in the country.
The fiscal incentives.
Yes. So Vietnam is very aggressive with their incentives, especially to the manufacturing companies who are leaving China. And even Indonesia is following the steps of Vietnam.
You always also hear about manpower costs also very high.
Yes.
And electricity costs also very high in the Philippines. And for warehouse, you have high overhead.
I would say those are the secondary reasons that were disclosed to us. But the primary is really the fiscal incentive. And according to some of the other international companies we spoke to, they're quite concerned about the constantly changing of incentive and local policies in the country, which, of course, when they invest
long term.
Long term, and they would like to have, they don't like any uncertainties in their investment.
Jet, have you talked to anyone from the government about these concerns that these companies would have?
I personally do talk to several officials on a regular basis, and I'm happy to hear that at least for the past week, I met with several officials, and they're quite supportive of revisiting this plan to, update the fiscal incentives that we can offer. We cannot just be reliant on our comfort zone of what we have right now. I think strongly believe that the manufacturing sector, we need to unlock the opportunities there, especially now we have 10% growth in warehouse supplies. Although occupancy rates are still hovering around 94-95% across the country, but eventually there are more industrial parks who will open, and they will need locators in their facilities.
Sorry, just one more thing. Driving at those incentives, what kind of incentives are other countries, most specifically Vietnam, what are they offering that we can't or we haven't offered yet?
Yes.
How big a difference are the incentives?
Quite significant, I would say, quite significant. And that is why even the labor costs and the electricity costs are usually secondary, because we're now at the stage where electricity costs can be lowered down by, we have all these renewable energy, solar energy, which in the next, medium term, these companies are predicting that it won't be a major problem eventually. And I think that as a country, we're doing a lot of efforts right now to promote renewable energy outside CBD. So for the fiscal incentives, these are the usual income tax, value-added tax incentives that are very limiting. Prior to CREATE law, we have several economic zones offering different incentives catered to the specific needs of different companies.
Let us rationalize a little bit all the incentives in the economic zones, right?
So, but now it was centralized. Everyone gets the same incentive. So whether you are a manufacturing company or a BPO company or whatever company, and you're foreign and you're enjoying the previous incentive, now you have a sunset period to enjoy those incentives. So I guess just in our view, as a consulting and a brokerage company, as someone who regularly meets with these occupiers, we continuously encourage our officials that they revisit these plans.
You have a regular publication. I saw one of your publications came out in March about the outlook for the industry as a whole. Would you be able to give us like a breakdown of how you think the industry will perform in the last remaining 6 months of the year and maybe in the medium term?
Well, yes, definitely. I think if I can start with, for example, the industrial sector, the market is constantly growing, and the over 90% occupancy rate is definitely a healthy sign of a growing sector for real estate. While for the office sector, for the BPOs, there were threats already internationally. Even way back 2020, we spoke to a few BPO executives who expressed that the U.S. is also promoting Mexico, and I think there's another region near the U.S.
More competition.
Yes, more competition, and they're leaning towards the nearshore, the nearshore BPOs,
as opposed to offshore,
all the way to the Philippines. So that can be a threat, and of course there's AI, and which can pose some threats. Although of course a lot of the BPO companies here are also upskilling our Filipino workers, but I think there would still be some negative effect to the office sector, and especially now we're still in the whole Metro Manila, we're still around 80% plus minus occupancy rate across different office buildings.
Well, thank you so much, Jet. Thank you for coming here and discussing all of these with us.
My pleasure.
Thanks, Jet.